John chapter 20. We're going to preach this morning on the why of Easter. The why of Easter. I'll let you sit this morning because I'm going to read more than I normally do, but I just feel like it's worth taking the time to read. John chapter 20, verse 1. The first day of the week cometh Mary Magdalene early, when it was yet dark, unto the sepulchre, and seeing the stone taken away from the sepulchre. Then she runneth and cometh to Simon Peter and to the other disciple whom Jesus loved, and saith unto them, They have taken away the Lord out of the sepulchre, and we know not where they have laid him. Peter therefore went forth, and that other disciple, and came to the sepulchre. So they ran both together, and the other disciple did outrun Peter, and came first to the sepulchre. And he, stooping down and looking in, saw the linen clothes lying, yet went he not in. Then cometh Simon Peter following him, and went into the sepulchre, and seeth the linen clothes lie, and the napkin that was about his head, not lying with the linen clothes, but wrapped together in a place by itself. Then went in also that other disciple which came first to the sepulchre, and he saw and believed. For as yet they knew not the scripture that he must rise again from the dead. Then the disciples went away again unto their own home. But Mary stood without at the sepulchre weeping, and as she wept, she stooped down and looked into the sepulchre, and seeth two angels in white sitting, the one at the head and the other at the feet where the body of Jesus had lain. And when they say unto her, Woman, why weepest thou? She saith unto them, Because they have taken away my Lord, and I know not where they have laid him. And when she had thus said, she turned herself back and saw Jesus standing, and knew not that it was Jesus. Jesus saith unto her, Woman, why weepest thou? Whom seekest thou? She, supposing him to be the gardener, said unto him, Sir, if thou have borne him hence, tell me where thou hast laid him, and I will take him away. Jesus saith unto her, Mary. She turned herself and saith unto him, Rabboni, which is to say, Master. Jesus saith unto her, Touch me not, for I am not yet ascended to my Father, but go to my brethren and say unto them, I ascend unto my Father and your Father, and to my God and your God. Mary Magdalene came and told the disciples that she had seen the Lord and that he had spoken these things unto her. As I read through that this morning, I think back over the years since I began to pastor a long time ago, and there's so many of these, and I'm sure Sister Debbie could say the same thing. There's so many of these passages of scriptures that I've used a phrase or a verse out of this passage to preach an Easter sermon over the years. And there's so many wonderful thoughts that we could preach, whether it's the napkin being folded or when he asked, why weepest thou? And asking who she's looking for. It's a message in itself. When she didn't recognize him, thought he was the gardener until he said one word. And what did he say? Her name. When he said her name, she knew who he was. That's a message in itself. There's a message right in the beginning that one of my favorites of this is in the very first verse. The first day of the week cometh Mary Magdalene early. When? When it was yet dark. So the resurrection hadn't happened. What we're celebrating hadn't happened. But by out of faith to her Lord, she was going. That's a whole message in and of itself. I don't have time to preach all of those, but I want us to understand and think of the tomb and trying to understand. They had placed the body of Jesus in a borrowed tomb, the tomb of a rich man, and they needed some place, and there's been songs written and lyrics written that it was only needed for the weekend. But Joseph of Arimathea had agreed to say, you can use this new tomb. And so that's where they placed it. But the Jews were afraid that somebody would come and steal the body and then claim that he was resurrected. And so they had went to Pilate, and I'm sure Pilate thought by now, I'm done with this. But they had went and they had asked if they could put Roman soldiers there at the door to guard that, not guard that Jesus would get out, but guard that no one could get in. And so they had rolled this large stone in front of the door, and then they had put the Roman seal upon it so that even if someone did manage to roll that stone away, they would know that the seal had been broken. But we know the story that he did more than break the seal. He rolled the stone away and he came out victorious and alive. That is the story and the hope of the resurrection. They put him in the tomb because they thought they had won. They put him in the tomb because they thought he had been silenced. And that's exactly what the devil thinks about a lot of people this morning. They thinks that he has you locked away. He thinks that he has you silenced. He thinks that he has won. And in my life, Tim, there has been days where the devil thought that I had been sealed in a tomb of death. And he thought that I had been silenced. And he thought that he had won. But I'm here to tell you, by the grace of God, I have been victorious over death, hell, and the grave, because the one that I serve is victorious over death, hell, and the grave. And because he's no longer in the tomb, I don't have to live in a spiritual tomb. Because he's not been silenced, I don't have to be silent. It'd be a hard time keeping me silent anyway. But that's what the devil thinks. And some of you right now, if you don't know Christ as your Savior, if you've not taken advantage of this hope of the resurrection, then the enemy right now thinks that he's got his hands on you. He thinks that he's got you right where he wants you. He's got his bony, crooked fingers around your neck, and he's just squeezing closer and closer, trying to squeeze the very breath out of you and to destroy you. But I want you to know there is somebody that can break you free this morning. There is somebody that can roll your stone away. There is somebody that can break your seal. There is somebody that can bring you from spiritual death unto spiritual life. And his name is Jesus Christ. And everybody in here this morning, maybe you don't understand why these songs make us so happy. When we begin to sing, and Haley was beginning to sing that song, I loved all the songs. I hope so. I picked most of them out, I guess. But there was something about the words of that song that begin to make me cry, that I was a wretch. I remember that line. I remember who I was. And some of you this morning can't understand why we're so happy, and you don't understand why these songs make us cry. It's not because we're perfect. It's because we remember who we were, and we remember how lost we were. But we're thankful to know where we are today. I may have used to be in, but I'm a now, right now. Amen. Beloved, now are we the sons of God. That's what the Bible says. It doesn't say we're hoping to be. It doesn't say someday, if everything works out, we'll be. Right now, I am a son of God because of Jesus. I got to move on. The tomb is symbolic. This tomb, it is symbolic. I mean, think about it. Just the word tomb. How many of you, now we had planned on going to Israel next month. No, at the end of this month, going into May. And it got canceled because of all the war and everything that was going on. And I know Mark and Debbie have been there. They have a tomb that you can go and visit. Is it really the tomb? Does it really matter? I don't care. I wanted to go. But other than that, how many of you have ever set out your vacation plans and on your itinerary was to visit a tomb? There's probably some of you weirdos out there maybe that did. But most of the time, that's not something that wants to draw people into a place where we know that the dead have been laid. And so just the very word tomb, it is symbolic of death and darkness and no hope and silence and sadness and finality. And it may not be a tomb, but we've all been to the cemetery or to the graveyard. And I'm here to tell you, if you've never been there by yourself, there's no more silent place in the world than a cemetery, knowing that everyone there has been laid to rest and realizing their soul, every person there, their soul right now is in one of two places. There's no limbo, there's no purgatory, and there's no in between. As a tree falls, the Bible says, so shall it lay. And when we leave this world, the condition of our soul has been set according to our faith or no faith in Christ. And so the tomb is symbolic. But all it took was one breath. I don't know. I read something this morning. Someone had posted. I don't know what began to happen first. Boy, I feel preaching coming on this morning. I don't know what happened first, but Jesus was there as every other dead person that had ever lived. His life was out of his body. His heart was not beating. His blood was not flowing. Not his breath, his lungs were not breathing. He was dead. But somewhere along the line, I believe that there began to be a light shine in that tomb. Not from the outside, because the Bible says it was yet dark. But somewhere inside that tomb, there began to be a light that would shine. And I don't know if the heart began to pump first or the lungs began to breathe. But something that showed life inside of our Savior began to happen. And when it happened, I believe hell began to tremble because they knew that the end was near.
Amen. Amen.
And so all it took was a breath. But not only is the tomb symbolic, but the empty tomb symbolizes life and freedom and power and truth, hope, immortality, and nothing. Understand this morning, all over the world, preachers are doing their best to preach the hope of the resurrection. And we're all preaching the same message this morning, of this, the same idea and the same topic and the same theme. And nothing of this story. There are no words that can compare to the message of the hope that we have. No words of Muhammad. No words of Buddha. No words of a Dalai Lama. No words of the philosophers, the statesmen, the presidents or kings. There's never been a man that can conjure up any kind of word or any kind of oratory that can compare to the simple truth that my Savior died for my sin, but he was raised for in the resurrection for the hope of my eternal soul. The words of this old song, I almost sang it this morning, but I decided just to sing He Lives. There's an old song that says, we sing it once in a while. Lo, in the grave he lay, Jesus my Savior. Waiting the coming day, Jesus my Lord. Vainly they watched his bed, Jesus my Savior. Vainly they sealed the dead, Jesus my Lord. Death cannot keep his prey, Jesus my Savior. He tore the bars away, Jesus my Lord. Up from the grave he arose with a mighty triumph o'er his foes. He arose a victor from the dark domain, and he lives forever with his saints to reign. He arose, hallelujah, Christ arose. The why of Easter. So you say, Mick, you preached all of that. Then why? Why does it matter? Why does any of this? Well, number one, I want to answer the question, why was it necessary? Why was it necessary? And I pulled up just to go to the next slide. I pulled up just a few quotes. I'm not going to preach on all these. Just a few things I looked up. Without the resurrection, Jesus' ministry ends in defeat. Without it, one can only pity Jesus as a dead martyr whose lofty ideals were sadly misunderstood. Without the resurrection, Jesus' death would go without divine interpretation and endorsement. The resurrection amounts to the Father's clear signal that Jesus is the powerful Son of God who has conquered death and reigns as Lord of all. And listen to this last one. Without the resurrection, none of Jesus' promises would be trustworthy. We're going to talk about that a little bit later. Without the resurrection, Jesus would be a liar. He said, if they destroy this temple, in 3 days I'll raise it back up again. It had been prophesied all through the Old Testament. He had told them. And so if he just lays in the grave for all of eternity, he was not who he said he was. This wasn't for show. All of the promises and the plans of God were laid bare in the tomb. Now or nothing. It was all down to this moment, now or nothing. Because if he had stayed dead, he was just a man. He was just a magician that pulled tricks on people that made them think they were healed. He was just a prophet speaking some wise words. He was just a teacher giving interpretation of Scripture. He was just a troublemaker, just another charlatan if he was still dead. But aren't you glad this morning? He is who he says he was, and he's risen. He's alive today. It is necessary because God said it had to be so. The why of Easter. Why? I know some people are thinking, why is this such a big deal? Why did my family bug me to come to church today? Why did my wife buy me this new shirt that I'll never wear again and make me come to church? Why does grandma and grandpa think this is so? Why is it necessary? Well, the next question, why didn't Jesus say no? We know that he goes to the garden and he prays, Father, not, and he said, if let this cup pass from me. But that was his flesh speaking. And he prays and his flesh dies out and he says, Father, not my will, but thine be done. And so he proceeds to go through the process of being murdered, to being crucified. And so we have these quotes. As we said, the same thing. If these didn't happen, so why didn't Jesus say no? Because the God in him, I love this, the God in him could not fail. It was impossible for God to let us down. Yes, he was 100% man, but the 100% God of him, just absolutely, it was never a question that he would somehow fall or fail or leave us in the limbo. He came that he might die. And he was going to see it through to the very end. And also, Jesus didn't say no because he loved us first. His love held him fast, and his love brought him out of the tomb. And now I'm going somewhere with all this. It's going to be different than any Easter message you've ever seen or heard, I promise. Number three, some of our church are going, he's going through these points so fast, he must have 10. I don't. Number three, the whys of Easter. Why does it matter now? Isn't that the relevant question? In 2024, why does Easter still matter? Because the empty tomb changed the world. Literally. It changed man's relation to God. It began the formation of the Christian church, the establishment of the church. And we see that from this empty tomb and the days that would follow when he would present himself to the disciples, when he would tell them to touch me not, and then he comes back some days later, and we believe that's after he has went to the Father and he has presented the blood sacrifice because he says, touch me not, I've not yet ascended unto my Father. But then he comes back and he tells Thomas, touch my side. See that I am him. And so he spends some time with them. But then the ascension, when they're on the hillside with his followers, and he gets lifted away on a cloud and he goes up, and they're all just standing there. He had given them directions. I want you to take this gospel. I want you to start here in Jerusalem. And then I want you to go to Judea and Samaria, to the uttermost parts of the earth. I want it to go all over the world. Right? He just told them that. And then they watch him go up on a cloud elevator. And so did they run right out and take the gospel? No, they just kept staring like we would. They were like... Now listen, this is not a miracle we talk a lot about. I want you to understand something. These men had seen a lot of things. They'd seen the dead. They'd seen Lazarus raised from the dead. Not too long before this, back in Jericho, they saw blind Bartimaeus healed. The blind could see. The lame could walk. They'd seen all of that. But they'd never seen that. I mean, he's there, and he just takes up on a cloud. Till they can't see anymore. They're just staring. All of a sudden, the angel said, "Ye men of Galilee, why stand ye here gazing?" In like manner, he's coming back again. So why does it matter? Because from that point on, they took this story all over the world. And listen, eventually, in the areas of Rome, many of them became martyrs. They crucified them. They burned them alive. They lit their bodies as lamps. But eventually, a man named Constantine, who was the ruler over the greatest empire at the time, becomes a Christian. Now, there's debate on what he did. He truly become a Christian? Was it political? It doesn't matter. It was all part of God's plan. And he said, "Hey, but from this day on, we're Christians." And it changed the world. All part of God's plan. That's why it matters now. It does matter now. And the hope of the resurrection still lives on. 9 years ago, April 5th, 2015, Easter Sunday morning, was the first service of Life Change Church up on the hill on Grassy Fork. 9 years ago. Why does it matter? Because we still need him. We needed him in 2015, and we need him today. He is still relevant. He is still alive. He is still God. He is still Savior. He is still Lord. And so Easter will always have a special place in our hearts here at Life Change, because that's when we got started. 9 years ago, I asked Bethany this morning, I said, "You know what was going on 9 years ago?" She said, "Well, yeah." And I said, "No, I mean specifically about this time." I had spent all night the night before with a guy that was helping me, a tech guy that was helping me do this stuff, get the TVs and the PowerPoints and the videos. We didn't have a band back then. And I was trying to get all that ready, and I had literally stayed up all night long. I came home about 6 in the morning and got ready, got dressed, and went back up there maybe about 8 o'clock, and nothing we'd worked on all night worked. Some of you were there. Nothing. And so we had to go back down into the basement, pull up the old song books. Yvonne played a song. I think Corey played the drums. And we had a couple songs. We did a couple things. And we had a wonderful service, but that's how we got started on the wrong foot. But I want to show you this morning, like I said, it's going to be a sermon like you've never seen. I want to show you the why of Easter. I want to show you why it matters and why it's relevant. Wherever you guys are ready.
See my hands and look at my feet. It's okay if it's hard to believe. I have faith that you will do greater things. It's my time to go, but before I leave, go tell the world about me. I was dead, but now I live. I've gotta go. I've conquered death and I hold the keys. Where I go, you'll go to someday. But there's much to do here before you leave. So go tell the world about me. I was dead, but now I live. end of the road. My spirit is with you wherever you go. You have a purpose and I have a plan. I'll make you this promise. I'll come back again. But until then, go tell the world about me. For I was dead, but now I live. Oh,
you made the way to deliver us. Look at how far.
Amen. So why does it matter? Why is it relevant? You are the reason that the tomb is empty. You are the reason that Jesus is Lord, because he said, I have to come out for life change, for this church, for Morgantown, for Beach Fork. We are the reason. Hallelujah. His love toward us. Praise his holy name. We, the object of his love, the object of his affection, we are the reason. He said, I'll walk Golgotha's hill. I'll go through the pain. I'll give my life because I love them. For God so loved this world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. We're just a bunch of whosoever's this morning. We don't claim perfection. We don't claim some kind of record holiness. We're just broken and undone people that have been saved by the grace of God, that believe in an empty tomb. As David and Tim, if they can come this morning, heads are bowed and eyes are closed as we stand all over the building. If you don't know him, you are why. Oh, I hope you can see that this morning. You may not believe it. You may say, I've been too far away. I've rejected him too many times. You're still why there's an Easter. You're still why there's a resurrection. Mick, you have no idea what I've done, and I hope I never do, because I don't need to know. But whatever you think you're hiding from God, he already knows. And while he was on the cross, he knew it. While he was in the tomb, he should have said, they're not worth it. He should have said, they'll reject me and they'll live disobediently. This isn't worth it. But through all of that, he looked down through the portals of time and he saw you and he saw me and he said, I'll go. If you need to be saved, if you need to come back to the Lord, if you need a fresh start, would you just slip out of your seat as he sings and come and let us pray with you?